Hey, Undisputed listeners, before we start the show, I wanted to tell you about our brand new Fox Sports app and website, foxsports.com, reimagined for the modern sports fan. Go ahead, download the new app right now. You don't even have to pause this episode. Every day on the new app and website, you'll see the top stories in sports, plus a rich world of written content, videos, social media, and analytics to give you a 360-degree view of the most important stories of the day. Streaming live TV has never been so easy or elegant. Every Fox Sports game, including all pregame and postgame shows, are just one click away. For the extra invested fan, we also go deep with real-time wagering lines, trending prop bets, win probability, and key player projections. Download the new Fox Sports app or visit www.foxsports.com now. Let's start the show. Welcome to the Undisputed Podcast. I'm your host, Jenny Taft. This podcast is the full show from today's episode of Undisputed from start to finish. We've got a busy slate, so skip Shannon. Let's get to it. Good morning. Welcome to Undisputed. We are live from Los Angeles. And of course, happy Thanksgiving. I'm Jenny Taft here with Skip Bayless and Shannon Sharp. It's great to see you guys. How are we doing?
I'm doing great, Jenny. Thank you. Skip, this is our fourth Thanksgiving together, and it gets better and better every year. Happy Thanksgiving to everyone out there. I know sometimes it doesn't seem like we have a lot to be thankful for, but if you woke up this morning, there's a lot to be thankful for.
Well said. Look, 2020 has been one of the worst years this planet has ever experienced. We're talking about a global pandemic.
Correct.
Yet there has been, for all of us, I think, one silver lining, one positive. We have been forced to stay at home, and we have gotten to spend more time with our families.
Yes.
So today, I am so thankful for my wife, Ernestine, and for our quote-unquote daughter, Hazel, our little four-year-old Maltese. And I'm so thankful for you and for Jenny and our Fox family here at FS1. Azzy, our producer, all the good people we get to work with here. Bless you all. And I hate to admit this publicly because I hate to do this, but I actually love you.
Look at that.
Yeah.
And thank you, all of you guys that tuned in today.
Love,
we thank you for that.
Wow, we're talking about love?
This look at him.
I still got a song.
You guys making me emotional here.
Yeah.
Don't try to soften me up on Thanksgiving.
Boy, I like it. This is a great start to the day. I'm also thankful. I want to say to my parents, they're in Minnesota. My dad just had knee surgery. I know he's watching. He's a big fan of the show, guys, and I'm thankful for both of you.
Thank you, Jim.
Out of the way, we do have a lot to talk about because Thanksgiving means football, and we've got a great main course for you coming up later today with Ezekiel Elliott and the Cowboys hosting Washington at 4 p.m. Eastern on Fox. Dallas is looking to avenge a 25-3 loss earlier this season, while Alex Smith hopes to continue his amazing comeback season with his first back-to-back win since 2018. So, Shannon, who wins?
I went back and forth with this one, Skip, and I know both teams won last week, but I thought Dallas looked more impressive in their win than the Washington football team looked in their win. But when you're dealing with teams like this, these are division rivals, and they go back, this rivalry goes back, what? It's, okay, 1960. So it goes back. It goes back 60 years.
I wanted to say it went back to the 1800s because it feels like it did. It does.
Yeah. I was thinking, I'm like, hold on. The Cowboys didn't exist in 33 when Washington, when obviously the football team that had another name existed. But Skip, so I'm throwing out records, and what this means is that the winner of this ball game will be in first place in this horrible, horrible division. And no matter what you think, how horrible it is, somebody from this division is going to get a home playoff game. I took Washington, Skip, because I'm looking at them over the last month. They're 2-2. They're first in pass defense. They're second in sacks, third in scoring D, third on third down, 10th against the run. And what they did the last game to Andy Dalton, they got after him. They sacked him 6 times, allowed 3 yards per carry. And the Cowboys are going to run the football because the difference between this week and last week, Minnesota could not pressure Andy Dalton, and he got real comfortable. So not only was he comfortable, they couldn't stop the run. The one thing I know about Jack Del Rio, the defensive coordinator of Washington, is that he'll shut off the run, and they'll put all their money. Basically, when you look at their high draft picks, it's in the defensive line. Allen, Payne, Chase Young, Kerrigan, Sweat, all those guys were first-round draft picks. one, Chase Young. Number two, the lowest draft pick was Sweat on the first line, and he went in the 26th pick in the draft.
Yep.
So I like Washington to choke off the run, put pressure on Andy Dalton. I'm going to make Andy Dalton beat me. Zeke Elliott and Tony Pollard, you're not going to play a role in this ball game. And Skip, as good as the Cowboys' defense have been, they've given up 24 passing touchdowns with three interceptions. So, in other words, they've turned every quarterback that they faced into Patrick Mahomes. That's what they've done. That's what the defense have done. That's what the numbers indicate. So, I'm going to take the Washington in a very close ball game. I'm going to say they win 2016.
2016, yeah. Says the Hall of Famer Shannon Sharp. Yeah. I hate to admit this. I disagree with nothing you just said, except for your conclusion. So allow me to frame today for you. In all my years, my 40-odd years of covering professional football, I have never, ever experienced anything like what is about to happen on, you can argue, the biggest stage this side, the Super Bowl, in this sport.
Right.
If my Cowboys win today against their arch rival, as you say, they're not only in first place, they're in the driver's seat,
yeah,
to win a home playoff game, to win the right to play a home playoff game.
Right.
Because they would win this division and somebody has to win it. If they lose today, they will plunge into the cellar of the NFC least. And I saw this morning that the football power index, if they lose, will give them only a 6% chance of winning the East. So think about it. It is going to be feast or famine, all in one afternoon on the Thanksgiving stage.
Well,
Skip, right?
If they win this game, they only got an 8% chance of making a playoff. That's how bad the division is, Skip.
Okay, I got it. But again, by strength of remaining schedule, Dallas is second easiest,
yes,
in the whole NFL. If they can beat Washington today, the team that beat them the worst of anybody they've played, the team that humiliated them, that ran them off the field at Washington exactly a month ago,
right,
October 25th, then they catapult from the doldrums, from me over here just in anguish, into a position of strength in the least,
right? Yes.
So today, for me, will expose or reveal who you are as a football team. Are you men or are you mice? Because this is a men or mice game. This is how strong is your backbone? How much do you care about winning the worst division by far, probably in the history of pro football?
Right.
Are you going to do what you did last Sunday at Minnesota, which was simply play the best game you played all year and win the most impressive game that anybody in the NFC East has won all year? That was the most impressive win to me. You could, yeah, argue with that, but given that Minnesota had won three straight and it was at Minnesota, that was the most impressive. That showed you the capability of this team.
Well, considering, Skip, they've only beaten each other in the division, so nobody's really, okay, had an impressive win outside of the division.
Okay. So, for me, I believe that you'll know from the first snap of this game. Mm-hmm. I believe Dallas will be ready to play this game.
Mm-hmm.
I think they will play a little harder than a team that, I agree with you, on paper, I think Washington's a little better. I think you've seen the Cowboys coming for 3 weeks. They were actually in position to beat Philly at Philly, but they had Ben DiNucci, a rookie at quarterback, and God bless him, I'm going to knock on wood for him. That might have been the first and last game he ever starts in this league.
Maybe ever plays.
Well, that's what I'm saying, okay? Then 2 weeks back, against the undefeated Steelers in Jerry World, I saw, wait a second, that guy?
Garrett Gilbert?
I saw him be in position to close the deal against the Steelers. And I thought he played well enough to close the deal, but they couldn't overcome the second team on the field, the referees.
There you go.
Okay, but did they not play well enough to win the game?
They did, and I think that gave them confidence playing with a third or fourth string quarterback.
Correct.
Said, hold on, that team is undefeated, and we took them down to the wire. So I think that gave them confidence even though they lost.
Okay, So now Andy Dalton is back at quarterback. He is not Dak Prescott, but he's not bad. Again, for those who have missed this point, he has made three Pro Bowls, you can say in his distant past, but
yes.
He has.
Yes.
He has played in four playoff games in his life. He has not won one of them, but you can't tell me this stage today is too big for Andy Dalton because he knows how this feels.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And for those who missed the point, in his first 5 years in the league, he averaged winning 10 games a year. So he knows what it feels like to go to Minnesota and win a pretty big game, right? Now it's about arch rivalry. Now it's about revenge. You got annihilated at Washington because you did not show up. That was the height of a locker room mutiny against the new defensive coordinator, Mike Nolan. Maybe even a mutiny against the other Mike, who's the head coach, Mike McCarthy. After that game, it was so bad that Jerry Jones cut every free agent that he had signed in the offseason. There were eight of them, and he cut every one. He got rid of them, or he dismissed them.
All of them are gone at this point.
They're all gone because he sided with the new coordinator. He wanted either younger or cornerstone players who were buying into what Mike Nolan was trying to sell.
Correct.
To stay. And right on schedule, they started to buy in. So the defense has solidified around the return of Leighton Van Der Esch from a broken collarbone in game one at Rams. Mm-hmm. Once he's come back, he can stuff the run.
Yes.
He will plug the hole. Mm-hmm. He will go helmet to helmet with anybody who comes into the hole. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden around him, it started to gel.
Right.
And all of a sudden, something started happening at Minnesota. There was one key player, one crucial player who did not play at Washington 1 month ago. He missed one game all year, and it was that game. And as you point out, Andy Dalton got sacked six times. He got knocked out of the game on a cheap shot by John Bostic. Mm-hmm. And what did you point out the following day? Not one of the offensive linemen ran to his aid,
right?
Nobody wanted to defend him. They went to see if he was still alive, right? But nobody wanted to fight over that because that team had quit in that game. That was in the third quarter. Okay, who was the one player who wasn't even out on the field who could have rushed to his defense? His name is Zach Martin. At Minnesota, he moved from right guard to right tackle. You hate Pro Football Focus, but I'm going to use it right now. For any player in the offensive line who's played a minimum of 600 snaps this year, guess who Pro Football Focus ranks as the best offensive lineman in all of football?
It's hard to argue.
Hard to argue. It's Zach Martin. Jerry Jones, 2 days ago on his radio show, compared Zach Martin to Larry Allen. What do we know about Larry Allen?
I just think Larry Allen's the best offensive lineman ever play.
Ever play, said the Hall of Famer Shannon Sharp.
He played right tackle, he played right guard, he played left guard, he could be left, he could have been, he was all pro in three different positions.
Okay, and he is also alongside you in the Hall of Fame.
Mm-hmm.
So Jerry is saying that Zach Martin is in the ballpark with Larry Allen. And you know what? That's a leap for me. That's probably too big a leap, but I think he's starting to earn that kind of respect around the league. So all of a sudden, when they moved him from right guard to right tackle, everything started to click, and Andy Dalton stayed clean at Minnesota. Yeah. They don't rush the passer very well because they've lost too many of their stud rushers. But still, all of a sudden, voila, Ezekiel Elliott returned to the living. He had his first 100-yard game in what seems like 10 years, but it was the first this year, right?
It's been what? He didn't have a whole bunch of the last half of last year.
He did not. It was because they were trying to run behind the new road grader who went from right guard to right tackle. Mm-hmm. That allowed Connor McGovern, who was a third-round pick 2 years ago, to go to right guard.
Right.
Joe Looney's back at center, and he's a veteran. He's well-traveled, started with San Francisco, but he was a fourth-round pick. He's pretty good at center. He knows how to play center. Connor Williams, I've never been the biggest fan, but at least he was a second-round pick, and he's been okay at left guard.
Because the thing is, Skip, what they wanted to do was get their five best offensive linemen on the field. Well, Connor McGovern is one of their better offensive linemen,
but
he plays the position Zach Martin plays.
Thank you.
So I can't get him on the field. So I got to bump Zach out, put you in.
And again, I'm not the biggest fan of Cam Irving, but he did start eight games for your Kansas City Chiefs 1 year ago as they were rolling toward the Super Bowl championship.
Yep.
He did not start the Super Bowl. He'd lost his job by then, but he's decent, and he's been, I'm going to give him decent at left tackle, solidifying taking two undrafted free agents out of the lineup right. at right and left tackle, right. right?
You get a better indication of how good he is. Chase Young will be chomping at the bit. It's his first big-time national televised game. Everybody's watching. He wants to show why the Washington football team selected him with the number two overall pick.
Okay.
Cam Irving's going to have his hands full today, Skip.
I would agree. But yet you got a fighting chance because you got the right people in the right places and they're starting to gain some confidence as a unit. Listen, Washington is seventh in this league in points allowed. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
But as you look at all that talent on paper that I would give a slight edge to Washington over Dallas, I think they've underachieved all year. I don't think they've lived up to all those high first-round picks that just it's a cavalcade throughout their defense,
well, I think a lot of that has to do with the offensive side of the football.
Okay.
Because it's hard, Skip, when you're that deficient on that side of the football. They started with Haskins, and he didn't get off to the great start, but he did come back and beat Philly from down 17-0. But they had Haskins start the next game, and they had Allen, and then, you know, Alex Smith is getting in there. So I think if they can get something going offensively, you can't leave your defense on the field for the amount of snaps. I don't care how good they are. They'll eventually wear down. This is a game about strength versus strength because your offensive line, Dallas, is going to have to protect Andy Dalton.
Well.
And they know they got to get – they're somehow trying to get – they don't want to hurt Andy Dalton, but if they can get the Garrett Gilbert, if they can get Ben DiNucci in the game, they greatly increases their chance of winning.
Yeah, no, I agree. My over-under on sacks today for Andy Dalton is three. Three or fewer, Dallas wins. Four or more, Dallas is going to be in big trouble.
Well, you better hope Zeke and Tony Pollard better get better have a game like they had last week.
Okay. Thunder and lightning. We saw a little lightning from Tony Pollard, and I expect them to go heavy Zeke, but with a healthy dose of Tony Pollard because he can get loose. He's got a burst, and up against Zeke, who seems to be running in slow motion occasionally, it looks even quicker than it probably is on the field. Right. But he got loose at Minnesota for a 42-yard touchdown. We just haven't seen that. Right. We don't get that from Zeke.
Right.
So I like the 1-2 punch that's starting to emerge.
Right.
I also, you know how much I love CeeDee Lamb. Mm-hmm. He made what I thought was the NFL catch of the year last week at Minnesota. You argued that Thielen's was better. I still don't think it was. But the point is, CeeDee Lamb is emerging as a force on this offense.
Yeah.
They're starting to use him more on jet sweeps, any kind of little reverse action, and he returns punts. And Jerry all but predicted the other day that at some point he's going to get loose on a punt return, and I do agree with that. We're going to talk about him later because Jerry went all the way to compare him to Deion Sanders' burst with a punt, and we can't go there, but we'll get into that later. I'm just telling you, I believe he will be a difference maker today because they have him in the slot. And if you try to defend him with a single slot defender, I don't think Washington can defend that.
Yeah.
I think he's starting to get more and more comfortable. Andy Dalton's starting to establish a wavelength with him. So I believe he could be a difference maker against this defense on shorter passes that will lead to longer passes.
Okay.
All right. So in the end, I'm hoping Mike McCarthy showed one piece of tape over and over and over again to the defense. And it was a run by a rookie named Antonio Gibson at Washington on October 25th that made it 9-0. Do you remember this run? Could we please see a run by Antonio? This is it. Did anybody try to tackle him? Did anybody do anything but wave at Antonio Gibson, including Trevon Diggs, who's hurt right now, but nobody tried to tackle him. Nobody tried to tackle him. Xavier Woods did not try to tackle him. I'm sorry. That was as humiliating a moment for me as I have suffered this whole football season as a lifelong Cowboy fan.
Well, I think that also, Skip, Washington, your secondary isn't very good. And Kurt, First Cousins, had a day. He was 22 of 30, 314 and three touchdowns. He had two drops. So really, he should have been 26 of 30.
Mm-hmm.
Your back end can be had. Now, the front four, the front seven is playing a lot better. You look at D-Law, he's starting to turn it up. Alden Smith, he's consistent with his pressure. They got some guys, Neville Gallimore. They got some guys
Randy
inside.
Gregory.
Yes, they got some guys.
Dorrance Armstrong that Jerry keeps raving about.
Right. But you're back in. If Washington can hold up, there are plays to be made, a la Tampa. If that front seven don't get there, the back end is vulnerable. Same thing with your Cowboys. You're vulnerable on the back end. Nobody fears your secondary, Skip. There's nobody. There's no Jalen Ramsey. There's no Pat Peterson. There's no Stephon Gilmore back there where you're like, man, I don't want any of that. They're not there. Washington defensive line against your this is going to win the game, Skip. This is not about Washington's offense. Yeah, you're going to have to move the ball. But if Washington football team cannot generate consistent pressure on Andy Dalton, you can't beat the Cowboys.
Okay. So what have I seen from Washington if I look at the scope of their season so far? They've also obviously won three games.
Yep.
And what were they? They were down going to the fourth quarter and still 17-14 against Philly in the opener, and they came back and won the game 27-17.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll give you that one. The Dallas on October 25th was highly impressive because that was their tour de force game, but it was against a Cowboy team that did not show up.
Right.
And then against Cincinnati, until they knocked Joe Burrow out of the game,
right,
they were down 9-7.
Right.
Okay, so they came back and won 20-9, and Alex Smith was just okay.
Right.
He's been below average in QBR in the four games he's played
right.
in. I think he's got a 43 overall average, so he's just been okay,
hey.
Just kind of hit and mostly miss. He's 2 touchdowns and 4 interceptions.
Right.
Okay, so how have they lived up to the 7th best defense in pro football? They haven't yet.
Right. Well, but Skip, if they didn't have the 7th best defense in football, they would be over. They would be, you know, they would be one of these teams like Jacksonville, or they'd be like the Jets, only won one game or won no games. That just lets you know how good their defense is. When you look at look at his QBR, look at Haskins' QBR, Kyle Allen, I don't even know if he had played enough to register a QBR.
Yep.
Their quarterback play hasn't been good this year. I mean, I love McLaurin. I think they can run the ball decent. They're not great running team. They're not the Tennessee
Titans. He's been limited in practice
right.
on an ankle, but still, he is a weapon.
Yes, yes. He can catch it, and he can run it. So, look, when these two teams get together, there are certain teams that one team might be 10-1, the other team might be 5-6. It doesn't matter. I know you don't like me. You know I don't like you. So whatever the records are, we're going to throw them out the window. We're going to scrap it up, and we're going to see.
That is correct. And I believe my team's backbone will show through today.
I ain't got no backbone.
Yeah.
Turkey bone.
Yep.
Yep.
Wishbone. Like
get broken.
Break it?
Yep.
Yep. You better hope so, or you're going to be up against it tomorrow because I'm going to be out of my mind.
You're going to be out of your mind because you're going to be upset. Skip, we've gone through this the last three Thanksgivings.
Mm.
The last three Thanksgivings, you come here on Friday, you upset.
Mm.
After Buffalo did a number on you guys, the Chargers did a number on you guys, we go through this every year.
Mm.
Every year we go through this.
You know, just a last quick stat. I don't know how, but Ezekiel Elliott on Thanksgiving Day has played 3 games and averaged 118 yards per game in those 3.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's one of those kind of Zeke. Maybe it's one of these games.
What about what is his win-loss average? That's what I need to know.
All I know is Tom Brady always says the season doesn't start until Thanksgiving. Well, mine is going to start today.
Because you don't.
Thank you.
On my old club, Shay Shay, me and you, Jenny, yep. Today for Thanksgiving, only got 2 dishes, Dubs and L's.
Really?
Yeah, which one you ordered, Skip?
We're not coming.
Oh, you coming?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're going to eat before the game, and then we're going to go straight home and protect ourselves from COVID.
That's okay. You know what? I was able to adapt. I do takeout L's now.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. Ain't no in route. Ain't no in dining. There's no out dining.
Really?
I do takeout L's.
Really?
Yeah, I get that thing to you.
Well, maybe you can give one to Washington as they board their flight.
No,
you're
pretty
busy today,
for the Cowboys.
Shannon. Really?
Yeah,
busy.
Been cooking all
takeout
night.
Takeout orders all day. I know. I don't know how you do it.
Yeah.
You manage so much around here.
No mercy.
Hey, Undisputed listeners, it's Charlotte Wilder here to tell you about my new podcast with Mark Titus called the People Sports Podcast. It comes out every Thursday, and Mark and I take one of the big stories of the week, and then we go off on tangents you never saw coming. This might mean that we start talking about the Dodgers winning the World Series and end up wondering if Knicks fans deserve happiness, or begin with LeBron's greatness and end up drafting our ultimate beer league softball team made up of old athletes. Whatever it is, the only rule of the show is that it has to be fun and funny, because these days we can all use as many laughs as we can get. So check it out wherever you get your podcasts and come down weird sports rabbit holes with us. We can't wait to have you.
No mercy.
Tom Brady was ranked as the league's 12th best quarterback entering week 12 by NFL Brady.com. Brady is coming off a very non-Brady-like game against the Rams Monday night, but his 25 touchdowns are still more than he threw for all of last season with the Patriots. So take that into account here. Shannon, where would you rank him among current quarterbacks?
That's still too high. Jenny mentioned that his 25 touchdowns more than he threw all last year, but she forgot that part. Them 9 interceptions is also more than he threw all of last year. Mm. So we got to make sure we get all the stuff in there, Skip Bayless. Mm. Now, this is where Tom Brady ranks this year. 25th in completion percentage, 25th in yards per attempt. He ranks 5th in INTs. He's 15th in QBR. It used to be, when I turned into the dictionary, more with less, there was a picture of Tom Brady. Now nobody does less with more. Mm. Skip Bayless told me last year, and everybody else hopped on this train also, Tom Brady doesn't have any talent, a broken down Julian Edelman. He has a quarterback that's now a wide receiver in Jacoby Myers, N'Keal Harry. Look at the tight ends, Ben Watson. Now what's the excuse, Skip Bayless? Mm. He has 2 Pro Bowl receivers. He has a Antonio Brown, who has more consecutive 100-catch seasons than any man in the history of the NFL. That's what he has. He also had Cameron Brate, a young and up-and-coming promising tight end. And he had the GOAT tight end, a guy that's on the all-century team. Why are these numbers looking like this? Mm. There's no excuse for this. So they got him at 12th. Now, I'm going to disagree. I don't believe Lamar Jackson should be in front of Tom Brady. But I also don't believe Tom Brady should be in front of Jared Goff or Phillip Rivers. Now, if I'm not mistaken, Jared Goff just beat him, and his team is 7-3 and second in the NFC. Phillip Rivers is 7th in completion percentage, 13th in yards per attempt. He's 1st in his division with 7-3. So those guys should be in front of Tom Brady. Now, I've been trying to tell you this all year long, and somebody keep coming up with all these stats about, oh, he's right there with Mahomes. I got absolutely no problem with the top 5. I mean, obviously, Mahomes, Rodgers, Wilson, Deshaun, and Josh Allen. Kyler, Tannehill, Derek Carr, Justin Herbert. Has Brady consistently played better than any of those guys? No. But here's something that Skip Bayless, he loves to bring up. Big-time throws. Pro Football Focus say Tom Brady has more big-time throws. But Pro Football Reference, who's another reputable, says nobody has more bad throws. Tom Brady has 83 bad throws. Did you know that's 9 more than what the guy that you call, oh, bounce it to him, oh, throw it to him, Wentz.
Give it to him.
Oh, give it to him, Wentz. W-I-S. Ugh, I Wentz every time he throws the ball.
Yep,
Your guy has more bad throws than him. And the game against, who did play, Jenny? New Orleans, that was it. Mm. Called a timeout. The kick a field goal. That should be beneath Tom Brady. Mm. That should be beneath them, Skip. And I want you to see this thing. This old blooper reel. Mm. Yeah, we got a blooper reel. The guy that you said are playing great should be the MVP. Hey, Jim, drop that track for me right quick. Mm. I need the people at home because they don't get an opportunity to see this old blooper reel. Mm. We got that.
Obviously,
we got that. What is this, Skip?
Yeah.
What is that?
Huh.
What is this? Skip, what is this?
He's trying to remind everybody that LeBron has won 4 championships and lost 6.
Okay, what about you're not allowed to throw past the ball forward. Mm-hmm. It gets deflected. And you can't have 2 forward passes.
Oh. Did he complete it?
What was this?
Yeah. Completed it. He had barely 2 fingers on the football, and he completed it to Mike Evans. That's an unbelievable throw. That was GOAT.
You can't do that. Yeah. It is illegal to attempt 2 forward pass. Mm. You can do a lateral and a forward pass, but you can't do 2 forward pass. So I have absolutely no problem. Actually, I do have a problem because Tom Brady should be lower. Tom Brady should be 13th, 14th at the best. Mm. But to make a long story short, to put a nice little bow on this, he's slightly above average right now.
Mm. Yeah, Shannon Sharp continues to tell me that, Tampa's going to make the playoffs. How can they make the playoffs with an average or below average quarterback?
Either Andy Dalton has a chance to make the playoffs, so does Walker to him Wentz, so does Alex Smith, so does Daniel Jones. Is that saying anything?
Okay, but let's exclude the NFC least. Okay. Then who else?
But here's the thing. Who are those guys that he's ranked behind that you would say Tom Brady is playing better than Lamar Jackson? Mm. Of the list, Mahomes, Rodgers, Wilson, Deshaun, Josh Allen, Kyler, Tannehill, Derek Carr, Justin Herbert, Big Ben Roethlisberger. Which one of those guys has he consistently outplayed this season?
Okay, it's my turn. Thank you very much. When it comes to Tom Brady, about everything that comes out of your mouth is nothing but tomfoolery. It is straight Brady hate. I have never experienced anything quite like this phenomenon of Brady hate. I don't know what it is. He's the GOAT, runaway GOAT.
This year?
In his life, obviously. He's already proven that. At 43, he's having an extraordinary year because you sweep under your little rug over there all kinds of greatness that we've seen from Tom Brady already this year. So let's look at the good, okay? You try to single out the bad, and obviously he's had back-to-back really tough games against the team that's allowed the least yards in all of pro football, the Rams, and the team that's allowed the third fewest yards, the New Orleans Saints.
You just said he's the GOAT, though.
All right, look at these goatish performances. So let's look at 6 of his 7 wins, shall we? Let's look at Denver, where your man Tua just lost his job. At Denver, he just got annihilated by the Broncos, right?
Brady, he beat Drew Lock.
Huh?
He beat Drew Lock.
Okay, well, okay, but he goes in there. He had to beat a Denver defense that can be pretty tough, right? Isn't the head coach a defensive,
yes,
like mastermind?
Fangio, yes.
Yes, he is. Okay, so Brady goes in there and throws for 297 with 3 touchdowns and no interceptions. And then the Chargers are ahead 24-7 in the second quarter. And in the second half, Brady goes 15 of 17 for 263, 3 touchdowns and no interceptions. And for the game, he had 5 touchdowns to 1 interception.
Big then, six, though.
Okay, but did he not come back all the way from 24 to 7 down? And then the Aaron Rodgers game, do I even have to bring this up? It was just a masterpiece from Brady with 2 more touchdowns, no interceptions, and a QBR of 97 in that game. Mm-hmm. And then at Las Vegas, it was a virtuoso by Brady, 369, 4 touchdowns and no interceptions, and a QBR of 89. And then here we go at Giants. It was a close game, and you thought they should have lost the game. But he was 2 more touchdowns and no interceptions and a QBR of 86. And then at Carolina in their bounce-back game after New Orleans, 341, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions, QBR of 92. I just gave you 6 games of the 7 that they've won in which in 5 of those games, his average QBR is 90. But guess what he has in those 6 games? 19 touchdowns to 1 interception. Is that good? That's 6 wins, 19 touchdowns, 1 interception. Is that below average to you? It's goatish.
See what you did. I love the way you did that, though. You took what he did in the second half against the Chargers. Did they not play the first half?
Mm-hmm.
You took what he did in the second half against the Giants. Did they not play the first half?
I didn't take the second half.
But here's the thing. You keep saying I'm just trying to figure out. If you're 25th in completion percentage, 25th in yards per attempt, fifth most interceptions in the league, and 15th in QBR, how do you get top 5? How do you get top 10 with that?
Well, let's go back to my favorite website, Pro Football Focus. Just 1 week ago, after the game at Carolina, the bounce-back game, Pro Football Focus ranked his overall performance, the grade it gave Tom Brady for his total year, the body of work.
Right.
Number 2 in the NFL and ranked your man Patrick Mahomes number 4. That was just 1 week ago.
Let that sink in.
Because I want people to remember that just a week ago, he was graded number 2. Let's not be prisoner of the moment of what happened against the Rams, who have one of the best, if not the best, pass rushes in pro football, right?
So let us think in for just a second, people at home. At the time of this ranking, Patrick Mahomes was 25 touchdowns to 1 interception and had lost 1 game.
Mm-hmm.
And the Pro Football Focus said Tom Brady was playing better.
Yeah. Now, I got it right here. Patrick Mahomes, a little blurb on him. Why is he ranked 4th? It has been an inconsistent season for Patrick Mahomes. It took him against a COVID-racked Raiders defense the other night. On Sunday Night Football, it took him to the buzzer to overcome them. They were down 3 starters. They had 10 players miss all of practice with COVID issues. What are you talking about? You were trying to drive a bandwagon that has a wheel that's come off.
Let this sink in. They're saying Patrick Mahomes had an inconsistent season. Mm-hmm. When he's number one in QBR, even at the time of this, mm-hmm. at the time yeah. of this thing, he's 25 touchdowns to one interception. And he's they're saying he's inconsistent. Mm-hmm. Yet Brady, at the time of this, had six interceptions, mm-hmm. had a QBR that was 15th.
Who played better at Las Vegas, Tom Brady or Patrick Mahomes?
But they got the same result.
Oh, barely.
But let me ask you a question.
Brady won 45-20. It was a masterpiece.
Let me ask you a question, Skip. Tell me the game this season or in Patrick Mahomes' career that he's had that was worse than what Brady had that night against the Saints. Mm-hmm. Just tell me the game terrible. This year.
And guess what Brady's defense was doing that night? Guess what it was doing?
See his defense.
It was allowing 420 yards to Drew Brees and company, and then it allowed 413 to Jared Goff.
You see what you did?
How are you going to overcome that at home?
Hold on.
Seriously, gave up 38 points to the Saints. Their first six possessions, they just breezed down the field, as in Drew Brees down the field.
But see, when Derek Carr beat the Chiefs in Arrowhead, you didn't mention anything about the defense. You made it about Mahomes. Mm. You see what you do when Mahomes lose? He didn't play. He is Mahomes.
I know, but he's transcendent. He's by far the best player in football. You tell me.
You told me he's the GOAT.
Well, I didn't tell you. Everybody told you he's the GOAT.
If he's the GOAT, you can't just score 3 points against New Orleans. If you're the GOAT, you can't lose to Jared Goff. And then the GOATs can walk off the field. Mm-hmm. GOATs hold their head high. Mm. I'm the man. You got me today, but I'm still the man. Mm-hmm. What do you do every time he get his butt kicked? Walk off the field sulking. Mm. Because, see, the thing is with him, look, I didn't even go to Skip Bayless.
Well, time out. What did Andy Reid say yesterday? That the greatest thing that ever happened to Patrick Mahomes in his professional career was after the AFC Championship game at Kansas City, in which that guy converted three straight third and tens in overtime to win the game and keep Patrick Mahomes off the field, didn't get to touch the ball. He went out of his way to go over to the Kansas City locker room to pull the kid aside and put an arm around him and say, you're doing it the right way and you're made of the right stuff. And Andy Reid said that was the best thing anybody could have ever done for Patrick Mahomes.
Think about when he did this. Mm. Patrick Mahomes had just had arguably the second greatest statistical season in NFL history. In his second year, his first year starting, he was 50 touchdowns, 5,097 yards. So why to go out on a limb and take somebody under your wing, Tom Brady? Mm-hmm. Nah, don't do that, bro. Mm. Because he saw Patrick Mahomes as being the equivalent of him. Mm. The problem that he has is if he doesn't view you as an equal.
Okay.
He doesn't view Nick Foles. He doesn't view Jared Goff. He doesn't view Eli.
They're not.
But they kicked his butt. So what did that say about him?
That Nick Foles kicked his butt because Bill Belichick's defense allowed the backup quarterback for the Philadelphia Eagles to hang 41 on him in a Super Bowl? Are you kidding me? You continue to give Belichick a pass for that?
Can I ask you a question?
That is the most disgraceful performance by any single unit in the history of the Super Bowl.
But when you talk about what Tom Brady completed those three third downs, with Patrick Mahomes on the field.
I just said he kept him off. That's how he won the game.
So that was the defense
fault. He had to overcome
that was the defense fault, right? That was the defense fault. Mm.
Well, what are you talking about? No,
you said
that was his fault because he did it.
Okay, so whose fault?
Who converts three straight third and tens? So, it's impossible.
So whose fault was it those interceptions on Monday night? Mm. Whose fault was it those interceptions that he threw against New Orleans?
I'm glad you brought that up. What have we seen from Tom Brady? Well, we saw him through the first eight games of this year. We saw him lead the whole league in what are called big-time throws, 20-plus yard completions. Am I right? And even now, would you believe that he's over 1,000 yards ahead in air distance of any other quarterback? And ironically, it's your guy, give it to him, Wentz, is second on that list, bombs away Wentz, because they're just like, I don't know what to do. I think I'll just throw it as far as I can.
Right.
Tom Brady is trying at age 43 to indoctrinate himself into an offense that is foreign to him and maybe not made for him at all, because he was more of a pick-you-to-pieces quarterback in New England. That's how he became the GOAT. That's how he won 6 of 9 Super Bowls and should have won 8 of 9 Super Bowls, because he threw the occasional bomb, but mostly he picked you apart, right? So all the way to now, they are 7-4. He, by 1,000 yards, leads the whole National Football League in air distance, okay? Yeah. How far is he throwing the ball? You tried to dismiss him as a dink and dunker early this year. You tried to tell me he's a noodle arm, that he's washed up, that he's lost velocity. I told you coming into this year, he's lost no velocity. Skip. Have you seen him underthrow any of those deep balls? No, they're overthrown.
Skip.
Okay?
If I'm a baseball player and I lead the MLB in pop-ups, if they don't leave the yard, what have I done? He's throwing all these, he's leading the air distance, but he's not completing anything. Okay.
But he did for 8 games. He completed more than anybody did. More than anybody.
The season's not
over.
He
was leading the league through 8 games, and then what happened?
What happened?
He said, I love Antonio. I got to have Antonio. Let's bring him in. Let's risk it. No risk it, no biscuit. He brings in the biggest risk he could bring in on and off the field, Antonio Brown. Huge personality, huge amount of baggage, obviously. But Tom said, no, I love this guy. He's going to be our difference maker, but we're going to have to do pay me now or pay me later. He's paying now for what could come back in big returns, big dividends near the Super Bowl if they can make the playoffs, because it's slowly but surely going to work with Antonio Brown.
And if it doesn't?
Okay, but what's just happened right now? Well, he's in a terrible slump throwing deep balls because he's trying to force Antonio into the equation.
Those don't get in slumps.
It's too much of a good thing.
Skip, you can't tell me, you can't say, well, hey, Shannon, Skip, what do you want me to bring you? Well, bring me this, this, and this. I bring you back and you get sick. Man, why you bring me this? You asked for it. He asked for Antonio Brown.
Okay.
So don't give me this notion about that it's Antonio Brown's fault that he can't throw a deep ball.
Okay, when he joined them, they were 6-2, and most people were saying that's the best team in pro football. And you're going to try to throw Antonio Brown into that dynamite mix?
Who asked
it's
for
going
it?
To explode
Who
on you.
Who asked for it?
He did. I
okay,
told you
then.
Why. Because he wants to go win the Super Bowl.
Okay.
He wants to stick it up, you know what's back in.
But Coach Belichick said, I told y'all. Mm. I told y'all that's why I was. See, that's why I was willing to let him go.
Mm.
Remember?
Yeah.
That's what you told me about the Clippers not trying to retry the trade.
Help me out. Do you see diminished arm strength in Tom Brady? You see it?
I see the same guy. As a matter of fact, he was slightly better in completion percentage
because
he was 27th last year.
I actually think his arm's a little stronger than it was in New England.
I will give you this, Skip. I will concede this. Even with that great talent, he's got so much more talent offensively. I'll concur with that. He's up 2 places. Last year he was 27th in completion percentage. This year he's 25th. Last year he was 27th in yards per attempt. This year he's 25th. And in QBR, he's 15th. Last year he was 19th.
Mm.
So he's slightly better with all that talent. Let that sink in for just a second. Mike Evans, Chris Godwin, A.B., Cameron Bray, Rob Gronkowski, the running back that's 5th in the league in rushing.
Yep.
And those are his Tom Brady's numbers.
Mm. Okay.
Now your guy. And he people had this guy ranked ahead of my homeboy.
And you're the one who's not gutsy enough to say they're going to miss the playoffs because you're still afraid of the GOAT. You know it, and I know it.
Everybody made the playoffs. He's
having a phenomenal year.
And remember, Skip, they had this policy now. They might take 8 teams to the playoffs for the COVID. So, no.
Mm.
It used to be you play your way in. Now they do it like hockey and basketball. Hell, everybody make the playoffs.
Mm.
We don't do that here.
No, we're not doing that around here?
No.
All right, you're just
Shannon,
fired up about
one
Tom
man
today.
You don't bet against, and you're betting against him as usual. It's 4 straight years
it
you've
hasn't
been wrong.
Watch
for
my
you.
Homeboy.
It has
My homeboy
worked.
Got something for him on Sunday.
Well, it is Thanksgiving, and that means so much football to look forward to today, including, of course, the Cowboys, the 3-7 Cowboys host 3-7 Washington at 4 p.m. Eastern on Fox, and the winner will move into first place in the NFC East. Well, at least temporarily, guys, as Philadelphia and New York also have 3 wins entering week 12 and could both find themselves atop the division by the end of the weekend. So, Shannon, who wins the NFC East?
Skip, you know I'm a big Eagles guy. But over the last 3 weeks, the head coach doesn't believe in the quarterback. So how the hell can I believe in him? You coach him up every day. You see him every day in practice, in the games, mm-hmm. in meetings, and you don't believe in it. Mm. You pause every time they ask you a question about his play. They ask you about, you know, maybe going in a different direction. You pause. You got to think about it. I got to make sure I'm saying, little do you know, in the pause is your answer. So when you pause about everything, Skip, they're like, well, damn, that should have been an automatic. No, we're not going in a different direction. Carson Wentz, our quarterback, blah, blah, blah. So with that being said, as much as I like the Eagles, and I picked the Eagles to win this division, nope. Washington, I like Washington's defense. I just don't think Alex Smith, with that, he's limited on what he can do with that injury. It's a great story. It's a great comeback story. And he's going to win comeback player of the year. Nobody else is even in the running. I thought Big Ben had an opportunity to win that award because he's coming back from an injury also. But being away 2 years, Alex Smith is going to win that award. So now we get down to the Cowboys and we get down to the Giants. I like the Giants because I think their defense is playing better overall than anybody else's defense in the division. And I love Daniel Jones, but he turns the ball over. But the last two games, he's played clean games. And Skip, if you look at them, they've lost 4 games by 4 points. That means that's a young team that's trying to find ways to learning how to win, and they're learning how to win on the run. And so with that being said, I believe as this season progresses, we got 6 games left, they'll get better. They'll win some of these close games. So I'm going to say the last game of the season will probably be for the division. And the Cowboys travel to New York. And that's going to be for the division. And I'm going to believe the Giants will pull it out. So I'm gonna go with the Giants.
Mm. So you're going to say that old 8-8 Jason Garrett, maybe with like 6 wins, is going to get his revenge on Jerry for firing him.
Yep.
Okay. I'm going to remind you, I've brought up the Giants several times in the near past on the show, and you have dismissed them by using the word they're terrible.
They are.
That's what you said.
They are.
Terrible, terrible, yeah. Terrible. And now you're picking them to win the NFC
East. Yeah, but then they're terrible, but I believe the Cowboys are terrible-er, the Eagles are terrible-er, and the risk and Washington football team might be the terrible-est.
Mm.
So.
Okay. I believe the Dallas Cowboys are going to win this division. And I'm not proud of that because you can't be proud of winning what's probably the worst division in the history of professional football.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. But I will take it because it's all I have left. And I'm starting to feel like my team has become a football team again. And I think it will end up being a worthy winner of the division. It's going to play a home game against a better team.
Skip, how you have 6 wins and 16 and you're talking about it's going to be worthy?
It's because they will have come back together, come from hell and back, because hell was at Washington 26-3 1 month ago to win this division. And the reason they're going to win it is because their closing schedule on just opponents' one-loss records mm-hmm. is second easiest in the whole National Football League.
Yeah.
Let's look at your Giants. Their closing schedule is now 22nd. Now, you could argue toughest schedule, yeah. right, or easiest schedule, however you want to look at it. The Eagles, 28th, quote-unquote, easiest schedule, right? And we get to Washington, their opponent today. They have the 17th easiest, hardest schedule left on opponents' one-loss records.
Yeah.
Okay, so second versus Giants, you like 22nd versus Eagles, 28th.
What?
And Washington, 17th.
You mentioned the Eagles. They got Seattle, Green Bay, New Orleans,
at
Arizona.
At Green Bay, at Arizona, at Dallas, and then Washington.
So, but your Cowboys caught a break because the Ravens were supposed to be playing today on a Thursday
yep.
and then play the following Thursday. But they're going to play Sunday Thursday.
Now they have a short
You're
week
right.
because we have Washington.
Right.
And then we get a whole week.
Right.
Right. We get 1 week
right.
to get ready for a Thursday night
right.
game at Baltimore.
Right.
Will we win that game? Probably not. But
if you can't win the game after that, because, Skip, you know how physical the Ravens and the Steelers play.
Yep.
There's no love lost in that okay. division. And this basically, that's a must-win game for the Ravens because I don't believe they can catch the Steelers for the division. They're on the outside looking in for the playoffs.
I would agree.
Forget okay. the division. You better yep. think about what you need to win this game for your playoff lives.
Right. This is do or die
yes,
as far as the playoffs
absolutely.
Go. Yep, I agree. So then the Cowboys then get a big, they get 10 days off right. to get ready for a game at Cincinnati. No Joe Burrow, obviously. They elevated what's his name, Brandon Allen from the practice squad. Okay.
Y'all getting all the breaks.
Okay, we should be able to win that game. Then we got San Francisco at home. Who knows whether
Debo back, most of it'll be back then. Y'all done. Y'all cooked.
Okay. Quarterback will be who?
Don't worry about it. Okay. Don't even worry about
it. Not sure about that. Then the point of this is we've got Washington today at home, and then we got the Eagles at home. And then of our three division games remaining, we go to the Giants. And to your point, I agree with you, that could be for all the quote-unquote marbles. Although, when these marbles, maybe it's just one marble.
Exactly.
Right? Okay.
You know what, Skip? I think the Eagles going to get y'all. Eagles, y'all going to lose the last two and lose the division. Okay, that's what y'all always do.
You better hope so.
That's what y'all always do.
Because I'm not seeing it. I'm seeing my team. You saw it starting to rise at Philly. You saw it rise against Pittsburgh. Rise up against Minnesota up there.
I saw it last year, too.
Yep. This is different.
Y'all had a division. And you remember, think about it. Y'all had like three straight years, Skip. All you had to do is win the last game and you lost with Tony Romo. You remember those? Go to Philly, Giants, you lose. Every year you had that opportunity.
You know, it's possible my team's going to win enough games to get to like 7-8 before the Giants game and it'll be over.
Bet a couple of cases you don't get to 7-8.
Nope, I'm not going to do it. I won't bet anything on this division in this
Exactly.
I'm sorry. But I will say this. I give you the Giants. I tweeted probably a month ago, don't be surprised if the Giants win this division because you could see them coming because they keep playing close games. Where did that start? It started at Dallas on that dreary day.
Yeah, they should have won that one.
That Dak got hurt.
Yeah.
New York goes up with Dak still healthy. They're up 17-3 in the second quarter. Dak comes back, then Dak's gone. Andy Dalton comes in, gets off to a rocky start. They're trailing. And what does he do at the end of the game? He throws. To me, the back-to-back two best passes anybody's thrown all year for the Dallas Cowboys. I want to remind you of just how good these passes were. This is against the team that you say will win this division. But these are rockets. These are Andy Dalton.
No, they
the real
better.
AD.
They playing better.
Yeah.
We ain't got
Here
it.
Here we go.
Good.
No, we've
we ain't got it. We ain't got it. We ain't got it.
Everybody.
We ain't got it.
It's on its way. Just be patient. It's Thanksgiving. You have to wait.
You got it.
For dessert.
We got
Here's
it.
Dessert. Look at this. It's a rollout on the dead run. He throws a rocket. Whew. And then he goes right back to Michael Gallup with another one that is exactly where Michael Gallup only can catch this ball and sets up the walk-off field goal. How good is that? That's what Andy Dalton is capable of doing. Again, he's not Dak, but he's not bad.
Yeah.
That's why I'm going to win this division because he's going to be a little better than Daniel Jones. He's going to be a lot better than Wentz. And today he will be a little better than your comeback player of the year, Alex Smith.
But Daniel Jones got legs. He used them legs. He might grow for about 70, run a 70-yard touchdown on y'all. He won't fall this time like he did against the Eagles.
I'm sorry. Andy Dalton is now the best quarterback in this division. You know it, and I know it. That's why I'm in the proverbial catbird seat.
No, you're
Am
not.
I
actually,
right?
actually, no. You're not in the proverbial catbird seat.
Mm.
But your day is coming.
Okay.
You're all gloating now.
Who's better than Andy Dalton? You already told me about Daniel Jones. It's like, yikes. When is he going to turn the ball?
You know, even though my guy's struggling right now, I'll still take Wentz.
You'll take Wentz?
Yep.
He is five clear of any other player in turnovers.
But
five clear.
But I know who's gaining on him in interceptions.
Who?
I know who's coming on him fast on the outside.
Is that all you got?
Coming fast on the outside.
This topic is not about him. It's not about the
goal. I ain't called no name.
It's about the least.
I didn't call no name.
Yeah.
Like I said, we just need Dougie P to understand this isn't 2017. You don't run the football like that. You don't have healthy Alshon. You don't have those guys. Zach Ertz isn't there.
Alshon is now healthy, but he seems to be no factor.
I saw Alshon. That's a shell of Alshon. That guy got 17 jerseys on, got Jeffrey on the back, but that ain't Alshon. The offensive line is, guess what? Out again. Lane Johnson's out again. Kelsey was in and out of the lineup, the center, with an elbow. They're not the same. So you can't call plays the same.
In the end, my team is in the perfect position to run away with this division. And you are going to have to bear the brunt of
it. You see how you do? You see what you just did? Instead of just saying, yeah, we're going to probably win this division, now you go all the way talking about we about to run away with the division.
We got a shot.
Run to what? Six wins?
Well, we got a break with the schedule. set up.
Okay.
All we got to do is win today.
This is gonna make
don't win today, all bets are off.
No, ain't no bets.
I won't say a word.
No, whatever.
Yeah.
You had to gave up on it. You told me you was done.
Well, I thought the whole division was done at certain points. I kept saying the Eagles they wouldn't put us out of our misery, right? Yeah. They kept going on the road and losing games that I'd say, how did they lose
that
game?
I don't
want
to put you out your misery.
Yeah.
Because then you don't ain't no. I need you to go along. I want you to have a long, painful
You just gave up on the Eagles.
The NFC.
I don't give up on
I didn't
the
give
teams.
Up on y'all not winning the division.
Huh.
I didn't do that.
Okay.
That's what I need.
Stick with your pick, man. I stuck with mine.
Long.
He's thinking about it. He's thinking about it over there. The NFC East, it just always gives us so much to talk about on this show.
No mercy.
You know, we got the Cowboys in action, and after snapping a four-game losing streak, Jerry Jones seems to be feeling pretty good about his team. When gushing about rookie receiver CeeDee Lamb, Jerry told a local Dallas radio show, quote, "I don't know that I've seen anybody since Deion Sanders that has that type of sheer step-to-step explosion." So, Shannon, is there any validity to this comparison?
No. This is crazy, Skip. This is ridiculous. Jared can't just give a compliment. He go to the umpteenth degree. Does he realize, Skip? Here's the thing. This is what I've learned in my years of playing, and when I talk to people about certain players. If they don't play offense, because Skip, you don't see rushing yards. You know, you see rushing yards. You see pass catching. You see yards. You see touchdowns. You don't realize how good a person is, but you cover time. I was in the league. He came in a year before me.
Yep.
I understand what this man represents. You're talking about one of the five or six greatest players to ever play. Arguably the greatest two-way athlete. Okay, you go him and Bo, but I believe he was a better in football than Bo was. Mm. You want to go back to Jim Thorpe? Okay, fine. But in this in the Super Bowl era, ain't nobody could hold a candle to that guy, Skip.
Mm.
This guy could run. When he left the league, he could still outrun CeeDee Lamb. People don't realize how good they don't realize how good Deion was, Skip. They really don't.
Well, I hope they do.
No, they don't. They don't. Well, they don't
do
it.
Clearly, easily the best corner who ever played.
Skip, do you? Don Beebe ran 4-3, and he broke a kick return. They used to have time on the kickoff coverage as a safety. Somebody break
at Atlanta.
At Atlanta.
Yes.
Don Beebe, go pull it up, go Google it. Don Beebe ran 4-3 on a kickoff and was gone. And watch Deion, how he tracks him down, taps him on his shoulder, and say, pull over. It's not even close. Can we go? Let's start with Dez. Guys that wore that. Let's start with Dez. I don't think we realize how good Dez skipped. Remember, in 2014, we was having a conversation. Dez, the best receiver in football. Let's go to Michael Irvin. Let's leave prime. Let's leave time alone. We're going to leave that one by himself. We're going to start baby steps. Let's get to Dez level. Let's get to Michael Irvin because he ain't going to never be explosive.
Mm.
Time ran 4-2.
Mm-hmm.
Pulled his track. He went to the combine. He wasn't even going to run.
It was legendary.
They're like, are you going to? Okay.
True story.
Yes, he took
his
sweats off.
He got his tracksuit off, and he's like, I don't want to. No, they said you.
No warm-up. No warm-up.
Didn't stretch. Didn't do anything.
And ran 4-2-9.
Mm-hmm. And put his tracksuit back on and left. Okay? That's him.
That's time.
That's my man, Deion. I did cover Deion, and I'll never forget what Barry Switzer told me after his first practice as the head coach of Deion Sanders. He said, it's like he's not governed by the same gravity the rest of us are.
He's not.
It's like he can move in ways like he's on the moon and we're all not. We're still on Earth, right?
Yes.
He did run, whatever, a 4-2-9, and he could still run it in his last year. It felt like maybe 4-4. But the point is, it's like when Michael Vick was in Atlanta, it was called the Michael Vick experience.
Right.
Deion was the Deion Sanders
experience
in Atlanta.
Yes.
When he was returning punts and doing this.
Yes.
Right?
And kickoffs.
Whew, there's never been anything like it.
No.
Okay, so Jerry stepped over the line and he stepped out of bounds. But I get where he's going because he's not trying to compare CeeDee to Michael Irvin or Jerry Rice, whoever, whatever, right. Dez, any receiver, he's talking more about punt returns. He's talking about power returns where he's talking about sheer step-to-step explosion. CeeDee Lamb goes 6'2", 198. Kind of Deion-esque. About the same. Deion's probably 6'1"-ish.
Yeah.
Maybe 200, right?
Maybe 200.
Okay, maybe right in that same ballpark. Yeah. But he's talking about the power CeeDee generates with his first step. He led all of college football a year ago in yards per catch at 21.4. Mm-hmm. And about half of those 21 yards per catch were yak yards because they couldn't get him on the ground. So he's saying in punt returns, Jerry says he's going to break one pretty soon. He said, I'm willing to predict it. And I think it's a pretty good bet he's going to break one because he's had a 20-yarder against the Rams in the opener, and he had a 20-yarder at Minnesota. He had a 19-yarder at Seattle. He was one shoestring tackle away from breaking that one at Minnesota on Sunday. Right. He'll break the first tackle just on sheer raw power. You call it desire, whatever it is. But he's talking about first step explosion and being able to hit your full speed immediately. That's what he's comparing him to Deion. Obviously, CeeDee timed 4.5. Well, he's like 3 seconds slower, 3/10 of a second slower than
Skip. When you come to punt return, Skip. The greatest punt return of he ain't even Devin Hester. Well, he don't have that kind of explosion.
Well, I mean, Devin Hester.
Yes.
All time.
Cordarrelle Patterson.
Mm-hmm.
Skip, we gonna
talk about. He's coming. He'll be Cordarrelle Patterson.
You think so?
I do.
Joshua Cribbs. Some of the great returners. Can we start with those?
I'm talking about a rookie who's starting to have a huge impact because he's a very special receiver.
Well, eventually, Skip, he's going to grow out of that. He's going to be too valuable for you to put him back
agree.
There.
I'm actually still a little surprised he's back there now.
Yeah, because you're asking for trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Trouble that you don't even have to create, but you're asking for it by putting him back there. Now, I see in situations, Skip, we need a big return because DeSean Jackson. Skip, remember, DeSean used to return punts, and he was tremendous. Now, you talk about explosive.
Remember the one at Giants?
Yes.
Remember what Tom Coughlin did after the game?
God. But he morphed out of it because he became too valuable as a receiver to put him back there. Now, if we needed a big return, okay.
Well, ironically, DeSean got hurt this year trying to return a punt.
Right.
Remember that?
Tyreek Hill was a returner. Kick and punt.
Was he? Asked Bob Stoops if he could return Oklahoma State against Oklahoma.
Yes, and then he morphed out of it. Mm-hmm. And I believe that's what's going to happen to him. Skip, the kid is phenomenal. And I believe he's going to be a very good receiver. But, Jerry, come on. You can get a guy. You can pat the guy on the back and say, man, he's doing, for a rookie, he's doing unbelievable. But to go to that kind of explosiveness, Skip, that's dynamite.
Okay, but this kid levitated in the end zone the other day. It was a poor pass. It was thrown over the wrong shoulder against a blitz, and he levitated in midair. He had to spin in midair and sort of reverse field and go snatch it.
What did Troy tell you about Deion? Mm-hmm. He said if he took a year, he could be a Pro Bowl receiver.
Well, he contributed to that Super Bowl team I covered in the 95 Cowboys. He caught some balls.
Yes.
He caught a couple balls in the Super Bowl against Pittsburgh.
Had a couple touchdowns.
Yeah. If he dedicated to the whole year, he would have been Pro Bowl.
That's what that guy was.
Well, I've always called him Deion the best athlete ever because people forget he was an all-state basketball player in the state of Florida out of Fort Myers.
Yes.
And then all he did was start in center field for the Yankees and the Braves and, Cincinnati and San Francisco.
And he ran. He was on the track team at Florida State.
He
and Sammy Smith.
Yep.
I think Dexter Carter was also. I ran against Dexter Carter. He's from Appling County. Skip, people don't. Like I said, Skip, because there was no. You got to go back and, you can read clips. And so I wish the technology that we have today could be back then so then you could see some of the things that he actually did to get an appreciation. Because if you didn't see it with your own life, Skip, people telling you about it, it doesn't do it justice. And if you actually saw it, like people telling you about Michael Jordan's 63-point game, but I actually saw it.
Yeah, so did I.
So you get a greater appreciation.
Okay, bottom line, Jerry's heart was in the right place on this, but his head was not engaged to his heart.
No.
Okay, I got it. No mercy.
Well, the Patriots get ready to host the Cardinals this weekend. Bill Belichick
had some great praise for future Hall of Famer Larry Fitzgerald. But he made a comparison that definitely raised some eyebrows. Belichick told reporters that, quote, he's to receivers what Peyton Manning was to quarterbacks in terms of that type of total obsession of knowing everything about the position and how to do things and how to convey those to his teammates. Peyton was obviously Tom Brady's primary rival in New England for years. So, Shannon, was this a shot at Tom Brady?
I don't believe it was a shot, but I can understand and see how people would take it and perceive it as being a shot because Coach Belichick coached Tom Brady for 20 years, and here you are heaping the utmost praise and adulation on someone that you really never coached, but you coached against. Skip, I think for me is that you said you like to give somebody some truth serum and put them in the hot seat or a lie detector test. If you were to ask Coach Belichick deep down, I believe he believes Peyton Manning is a better quarterback than Tom Brady.
I think that's obvious right here.
I believe he does. Yep. Because, Skip, he spent 17 seasons knowing that if I can't beat this guy, I can't get to my ultimate destination, AFC Championship game, or if it's in the AFC Championship game, if I can't beat him, I can't get to the Super Bowl. And this is what all you need to know, what Coach Belichick thinks about Peyton Manning. Mm-hmm. He had the ball 4th-and-2 on his own 28-yard line with a lead. Instead of punting the football, he went for it. That's the equivalent of Buck Showalter walking Barry Bonds with the bases loaded.
I wouldn't go that far.
Skip.
Come on.
Pitch to him.
He tried to win the game.
Belichick tried to win the game. He didn't want Peyton to get the ball because he knew what Peyton could do. He ever did that?
I liked it. I said the next day, I liked him going for it.
They ever did that with Tom Brady? Anybody ever went for it on 4th-and-2 on their own 29-yard line against Tom Brady? Yeah, a simple yes or a simple no. No! I answered for you, no. Skip, I think the thing is that, and it's hard to say right now, that Tom wouldn't do what Peyton's doing because Peyton will reach out and talk to other quarterbacks, and I think it's a little hard for Tom to do that now while he's currently playing. That's not to say that once he's out of the league, he won't be the equivalent, the ambassador that Peyton is. Mm. That's not to say that he won't. That's not to say that he will. Fitz, I know Fitz. I know, got to know Peyton a lot better because once he came to Denver, so I know him, and I know Fitz. Talk to Fitz. He is, Skip. He's not to say Tom isn't class personified.
I'm with you on that. All that Belichick said about Larry Fitzgerald, bingo.
And maybe, Skip, maybe Peyton and Fitz are more approachable than Tom, or people feel that they can approach Peyton and Fitz more than they can approach
maybe.
Tom.
I'll give you that.
Maybe that has something to do. But Skip, remember, I always told you, Skip, you have to be careful when you play with other great players or you coach a great player and you give praise to someone else. Mm-hmm. People will take it as you're slighting the guy that you played with or that you coached. So you have to be careful. So I can see how people would think that Coach Belichick is while giving praise to Larry Fitzgerald and that helped him win 6 Super Bowls.
Mm. I'm sorry, but Bill Belichick is the shrewdest of operators. He does nothing without premeditation. He looks before he leaps, and he leaped all over Tom Brady with this one. This was a pointed, premeditated, blatant shot at the quarterback he benefited from for 19, 20 years. This was calculated disrespect of Tom Brady. It was calculated discrediting of Tom Brady because I'm going to reread the quotes about Larry. He said he's a very dedicated football player. He works extremely hard. He's very knowledgeable in all phases. And then he likens him to Peyton, that Peyton was to quarterbacks what Larry was to receivers in terms of the total obsession of knowing everything about the position and how to do things and how to convey those to his teammates.
Right.
For me, Tom Brady is beyond even Peyton in all those categories. And Bill knows that better than anybody because he lived with him and he watched him work. He watched his obsession. He watched him go home at night and just pour over tape and call Josh McDaniels basically in the middle of the night. How about this? How about that? You can't tell me that Peyton was more obsessed with winning football games or playing quarterback than
Tom
Brady?
I believe it equal to, because, Skip, you have to understand now, everything that they did walk through, that was Peyton. The game plan that they put in was Peyton.
I got
Peyton.
It. So I'll give you 50-50. I don't even know how to quantify the obsession. But those two guys are neck and neck.
Yeah.
So if you're Bill Belichick and you coached Tom Brady, you had the honor of playing with Tom Brady, benefiting from Tom Brady for all those years, at least you'd give him a little nod, like a 1A nod. Tom was great, too.
Well, right? How about this? Say, you know, Larry has that obsession and dedication like Tom and Peyton. Because if you leave Tom out that you coached for 20 years...
It's glaring. Glaring. It just screams at you, what about Tom?
Right, and people would take it as a slight, Skip. I guess who took it as a slight? I know who did take it as a slight, the guy down in Tampa currently.
I'm sure he did. He will never admit it publicly, but he took it as a private slight.
Yes.
Okay, just for the edification of our younger viewers, just to put this in some perspective, Peyton Manning finished his career with a playoff record of 14-13. Mm-hmm. 14-13.
Right.
Peyton Manning, as an Indianapolis Colt, lost 7 times in the first playoff game that he played.
Right.
One of those times, he had the number one seed and lost a home first playoff mm-hmm. game. And twice more, as the number two seed, he lost a home first round for them, first playoff game of the playoffs, right? So that's 7 times they underachieved. And if you look at Peyton's Super Bowl record, he did beat Rex Grossman in one of them in the rain in Miami. You remember that?
I do.
He also lost to the Legion of Boom 43-8. Mm-hmm. Brady never had one of those. And he did play the Legion of Boom, and he was down 24-14 in the fourth quarter and came back, as you know, with 124 yards passing just in the fourth quarter and 2 touchdowns to overcome them.
Right.
Controversial ending, I give you that. But Brady did his part to win that game.
Right.
And then Peyton finished his career for your Denver Broncos against Cam Newton, the MVP in the Super Bowl. And Peyton had a QBR in that game of 9 on a scale of 0 to 100 because he got sacked 5 times. He threw for a grand total of 141 yards, and it did not matter because Von Miller just basically tore Cam apart that day, and Cam was even worse than Peyton was in that game, right? Mm-hmm. So they won 24-10, and he can go out with 2 rings and 1 Super Bowl loss. He won 2 out of 3, and obviously...
No, he lost 2. He lost the Saints.
Oh, I forgot he lost to the Saints. Oh, so he's 2-2. I blanked that one out. He played pretty well, but he did throw an interception that lost the game at the end. Okay, that's right. 2-2. So Tom obviously is 6-3 so far in the Super. He'd like to have another 1 or 2 in his future, but he's at this point 6-3 in the Super Bowl. And remember, in his losses, he had what looked like the game-winning drive against Eli with 2 minutes left. He threw a touchdown pass to Randy Moss to put them ahead 14-10, and then you know what happened the rest of the way to Belichick's defense. And then, obviously, there was the Wes Welker drop. I thought it was not the best pass Tom has ever thrown, but it cost them that game that they narrowly lost 21-17 to Eli in the second Eli Super Bowl.
Right.
And then Tom throws for a record 505 yards in any playoff game ever against the Eagles and loses 41-33. Throws a Hail Mary to Gronk and hits him in the hands in the end zone to win the game, or at least tie the game at that point.
With a 2-point conversion.
And he did not hold on.
Skip, I think the thing is also is that when Peyton lose, they're like, well, Peyton, you're calling all the plays. This is your offense. Because, see, they gave Peyton more credit for wins and more blame for losses than they gave Tom. Because this was Peyton doing all this stuff at the line, which we never see Brady do. Brady obviously checks, but Peyton is this magician at the line of scrimmage. And he's orchestrating everything. And I think that's why people give Peyton so much more credit, because so much was more on his plate. Now, that's not to say that Brady was not as good or this or that, but I think for Coach Belichick, he's looking at it like, if I'd have had Peyton with his knowledge of what he did, there's no question in my mind, I wouldn't have lost any of these Super Bowls.
So you think Peyton would have won 9 for 9
Super Bowls? I'm saying that's what Coach Belichick believed. No. Just like I don't believe Jordan would have been 8. No. Mm. But we'll never know.
That's a cake.
We'll never know.
That's easy.
All I know is what the GOAT said. The GOAT coach said.
Yeah.
He spoke now. Huh. He's spoken. Now, let's not, you know, try to refute what the GOAT said.
The GOAT coach?
Yes!
Is only the GOAT coach in your mind because of Thomas Edward Patrick Brady Jr.
Well, over the last 3 weeks, Thomas Edward Patrick Jameis Winston Brady Jr. Has thrown a bunch of interceptions.
So you think he's... What are you saying Jameis is better than Tom Brady?
There you go.
That's what you seem to be indicating.
I'm indicating that he looks a lot like Jameis throwing them interceptions, doesn't
really?
He? Yeah. You remember against New Orleans? How many did he throw against New Orleans?
How many did Jameis throw last year? How about 30 plus 5 lost fumbles?
Well, you got coming.
That was by 12, the most turnovers in the whole National Football
League. He might catch your walking to him, Skip. The man
you think
spoke.
So?
Why you got hold on. Why you got to refute everything the man said? The man said Peyton and Larry have a lot of similarities.
Yeah.
They're obsessed. And they're to what Larry is to the wide receiver position, what Peyton.
Mm.
He didn't say nobody else. He didn't say Peyton.
This is classic petty Belichick.
They don't petty.
Yeah, it's as petty as you can get.
I don't know, Coach Belichick all right with me and my book.
Yeah,
I'm sure. Kind of read between the lines a little bit there.
Why you got to read between the lines? The man said what he said.
He knows what he's saying.
He said what he's saying.
He knows. He says it just so sly, you know? No mercy. We've got a great main course for you coming later today with Ezekiel Elliott and the Cowboys hosting Washington at 4 p.m. Eastern on Fox. Dallas is looking to avenge a 25-3 loss earlier this season, while Alex Smith hopes to continue his amazing comeback season with his first back-to-back wins since 2018. We're now joined by former Cowboys cornerback Orlando Scandrick. Orlando, happy Thanksgiving. And you know, Thanksgiving means Cowboys football. So will Dallas get their revenge today?
First of all, I want to say happy Thanksgiving, Jenny. Happy Thanksgiving, Skip. Happy Thanksgiving, Shay Shay.
Thank you, bro. Same to you.
It's going to be a tough game. It's a tricky game. It's a division opponent. Two teams that don't like each other. Washington, they're the type of organization, fan base, that they can lose 15 games or 14 games, and as long as they beat the Cowboys twice, they had a great season. It's going to be a tough game, though. I think Dallas is playing a lot better. They've got some life on defense. They're running the ball through Zeke. They're not turning it over. They're getting some turnovers. But do they get some revenge? I would like to say they do. You know, in my heart, I would like to see them win. But, you know, I'm not too confident on this team putting together back-to-back wins yet.
I thought you were going to come out here and say, oh, absolutely.
Well, I thought we were heading that way.
Yeah,
and then all of a sudden, we reversed field.
You know, every time I come out here and I hand somebody a victory, you know, I got to eat my words. I end up owing yak. I still owe some yak.
Huh. So are you saying you're getting gun-shy on this show?
I'm not getting gun-shy at all. I just think that the Washington football team have a really good front four, really, really good front four. And I think if Dallas has any weakness right now on their offense, they got great skill players. The quarterback's an established veteran guy that's above average. But up front, you know, they're playing with some mismatched lineups. They're playing with Zach Martin. We're going to see exactly how good of a tackle Zach is this evening versus Chase Young. And then just that Washington football team with Payne, with Allen, with Sweat, with Chase Young, and then having Ryan Kerrigan as your situational rusher, that's a scary sight.
I mean, you think about it, and that's something. Kerrigan is a multi-time Pro Bowl player, and now he's their situational pass rusher. It just goes to show you the depth at which they had on the offensive line, and their defensive line, and how they built this football team. I agree with you. I took Washington, but I thought the Cowboys win last week. They looked more impressive in beating Minnesota than Washington looked in beating Cincinnati. Cincinnati was doing a pretty good job until Joe Burrow went out of the ball game, and then Washington took that ball game over. I'm still not 100% sold that in a situation like this, Alex Smith is the guy that's going to deliver this team to several victories. And you got to be able to get away. You got to be able to move. And I'm just, like I said, I commend him. Kudos for you, Alex, for coming back from that horrible injury, but I just haven't seen it yet. I haven't seen enough yet. Enough good plays consistently to say, okay, yeah, that he's ready and this team is ready to turn the corner offensively. Over the last month, they're number one in pass defense, second in sacks, third in scoring D, third on third down, getting people off the field. You can win with that. The question is, can the Cowboys reestablish what they got last week, which was running the football, playing through Zeke, playing through Tony Pollard, and then play action and giving Andy Dalton time to throw the football? If they can't protect Andy Dalton,
you can't beat this football team. And that's what they were able to do last time. They shut off the run, and then they put pressure on Andy Dalton. But I'm gonna take the Cowboys. I took the Cowboys. I ain't taking the Cowboys.
I think that was a Freudian slip.
It was.
I
got Washington 20-16. I don't think it's gonna be one of these games with up and down the field, because I think both teams' defenses are playing better. But I'm gonna take the front four of Washington to get to Andy Dalton. I'm gonna say they get him at least five times. Mm-hmm. They limit. I'm not gonna say they shut him down, but they limit Zeke. And they win 2016.
Mm. So I just heard both of you guys, Orlando first, Shannon second, heading toward Dallas, knowing the back of your mind, you're like, they've arrived. They just pulled off the best win on the road at Minnesota that any NFC least team has pulled off all year. That was the most impressive win any team in this division has had all year. And they will parlay that momentum in getting revenge today. I am not afraid to say this. I got the courage of my conviction. My team is back in the driver's seat in this division.
The driver's seat.
Yes, they're in the driver's seat. They play by far the easiest remaining schedule in this division, but the first order of business is to get revenge by simply playing harder than Washington plays today. Washington ran them off the field 1 month ago, October 25th at Washington.
They did.
It was annihilation and humiliation. They ran for 208 yards. I have no idea how, except that it was all-out mutiny on the part of my team against Mike Nolan, the new coordinator. After that game, Jerry Jones said, enough of this. I'm going to bet on Mike Nolan. I'm going to clean house. He cleaned that locker room. He got rid of 8 veteran free agents he had signed to shore up and bolster that defense. And I believe all 8 of them had balked at Mike Nolan and what he was trying to teach or install defensively in Dallas. They didn't buy it, and I don't blame them for not buying it, but Jerry had the guts to just say, enough of all that. I'm going with Mike Nolan. I'm going to bet on the two Mikes, Mike McCarthy and Mike Nolan. And all of a sudden, the guys remaining on defense are starting to buy in because it's starting to look like a real defense, right? They are starting to stop the run. They at least controlled Dalvin Cook last week.
I get it. I don't take nothing from you. But when you get to these division games, and Shannon, you played in the AFC West, you played with Baltimore, you played in the AFC North. You don't really care about what your record is, who bought into what, who you beat last week. This game is going to come down to who wants it more. Who plays better, who makes the least amount of mistakes, and the team that plays better, not necessarily the better football team, but the team that plays better today on Thanksgiving is going to win.
And you look at Andy Dalton, the thing that Minnesota was unable to do was to make Andy Dalton uncomfortable. They don't have, you let Linval Joseph go, Danielle Hunter is hurt, Everson Griffin now, he was in Dallas and now he's in Detroit. They can't rush the passer. The one thing the Washington football team can do, they can get after your quarterback. And the Dallas secondary, everybody that they play against looks like my homeboy against the Dallas secondary. 24 touchdown passes allowed, 3 interceptions. That's very good. And if you can't do any better than that, you're not going to beat Washington. Even the Washington football team can beat you if you can't consistently get pass rush or your secondary can't take the ball away.
Mm. So, Orlando. Yes. You played with the Dallas Cowboys. You played with a guy named Zach Martin. I think he's the best offensive lineman in football. Would you concur after what you've... I know you played with some good ones in Philly also.
I think he's the best guard in football. There's some really good tackles out there. The guy in Green Bay, Bakhtiari. Really good tackle. Keeps Aaron Rodgers clean. But, if you made the argument that Zach Martin is the best offensive lineman in football, I could agree with you.
Okay. So they have moved him to a position he does not know, right tackle, so they could get Connor McGovern, their third-round pick a year ago, into his position, which is right guard. All of a sudden, it took off. It solidified. Is Zach Martin as good a tackle as he is at guard? Probably not. But Larry Allen, Jerry Jones compared Zach Martin to Larry Allen, Shannon thinks he's the greatest offensive lineman ever, right?
Yeah.
Well, Larry Allen played everywhere.
Yes.
He played all over the line, left tackle, left right guard, and right tackle, right?
Mm-hmm.
So Zach Martin is showing you just how great he is because he was road grading Sunday at Minnesota. again, the front is not what it used to be, but again, they solidified around that. Now they have a credible offensive line, and I do not believe Chase Young or Montez Sweat will have their way with Andy Dalton like they did. Because remember, Zach Martin missed the game, and it's the only game he missed with the concussion. That will change the balance of power today.
Payne and Allen gonna eat them guards. Mm-hmm. Payne and Allen gonna eat.
I agree. But they did it once. But, you know, my papa used to tell me when I was growing up, even the trash can get a steak sometimes.
So you back it out? You going with the Cowboys?
No. Even the trash can get a steak. They got to show me they can do it twice before I'm gonna come out here and go with the Cowboys. As much as I want to see them pull it out, I just don't think that they're there yet. I think that they're playing better, but I don't think that they're there yet.
Okay, so my final thought is this. With all that talent on the field, and I told Shannon, on paper, Washington is a little better than Dallas because of all those high picks on defense. Why have they only won 3 games? Those 3 are, they were losing to Philly in the opener and came back to win it. They were losing to Joe Burrow until they knocked him out of the game and came back to win it. And then they bum-rushed Dallas right out of Washington.
Yep.
So that's it. That's all you got to show for it. Why is that?
Hold on.
Quarterback play. Inconsistent quarterback play.
That's what I tried to tell him. But, we go to all these magazines, Pro Football Focus and Pro Football Reference and everybody. When it comes to most talented, what does everybody say? The Cowboys are one of the top 5 talented teams. So why y'all only got 3 wins?
Well, we lost our quarterback.
But hold on. Okay. If you talented, you can overcome that. You can put around him and pick right up where you left.
Okay, and I told you, we mutinied against the 2 new coaches, the coordinator and the head coach.
Well, the problem was, Skip, is that you guys had success. Look at the Raiders on Sunday night, Skip. You see how they were giving up the edges? Because Rod Marinelli is the D-line coach, and he does a lot of slanting. You guys were still trying to do that, getting out of position.
Mm-hmm.
Now Mike Nolan got you guys playing straight up. You're playing a little better defensively, aren't you?
Playing a lot better defensively.
Okay, then, but you're still going to catch this L.
Yeah, I'll take Andy Dalton over Alex Smith any Thanksgiving day.
Well, you take it today because the man just came off a gruesome injury. Mm-hmm. But I got the takeout L for him today. Mm-hmm. You know, ain't no in-room dining. Yep.
Shannon's going to be very, very busy.
This turkey been cooking for like 3
Thanksgiving,
hours.
All day. Orlando, thank you for your time. Have a great Thanksgiving. And we'll check in with you very soon.
No mercy.
According to some next-gen stats, Tom Brady is 0-for-19 on deep passes that travel 20-plus yards in his past 4 games. Meanwhile, his replacement in New England, Cam Newton, is 4-for-7 for 145 yards and a touchdown on those throws. For Bucs fans, this has to be a bit of a concerning stat considering Bruce Arians' offense is built around the deep ball, the no-risk-it, no-biscuit philosophy. So, Shannon, has Tom Brady become a deep ball liability in an offense based on throwing the deep ball?
Well, Skip, that was really never his ability to do that. With the exception of 2007, 1 year in his 21-year career, Tom Brady was very great and proficient at throwing the deep ball. You're asking a man to do something in year 21 that he hadn't done in 13 years. That's not Tom Brady's strength. Tom Brady is all about picking you apart. Julian Edelman, Wes Welker, Dan Amendola, James White, Kevin Fox, all these guys. Skip, that's his game. You asking him to do something that's not what he's been doing. Brady is also a part of the problem, Skip, because when you signed up for this, you knew the offense that you were going to. Or you need to have us like, Bruce, how much leeway are you going to be willing to give me in this offense? Because really, this is not, Skip, when you become a free agent, man, I wasn't trying to go to no team, Skip. All they did was run the football. Yeah, I need to throw. How are you going to use me? Are you going to let me do some of the things that I did in Denver? I'm not saying everything that I did.
Well, you did go to a team that allowed you 1 pass a game, right? And it worked, right?
Well, Skip, that wasn't what I was told. I was told I was going to be, although I wasn't be as involved in the offense as I was in Denver, you know, we're going to find ways to get you the football. Well, it more to get the football when I could and try to make the best of the situation.
Yep.
But in this situation, Skip, they're asking Brady to do something, Skip, that he's really never done. Mm. I'm a firm believer. If they would just say, Brady, it came out better, Skip, learning Brady's offense. Bruce Arians, Byron Leftwich. Okay, Tom, give us your – because I'm sure Tom got the playbook.
All these years, it's hard for me to believe Skip Bayless. He didn't keep at least one playbook. And it would be easier for Mike Evans and Godwin and those guys to learn what Tom does as opposed to Tom doing what they do. Because throwing the ball down the field, Skip, that's not his strong suit. Let him nickel and dime. You make the mistake, Tom pick you apart. But to ask him to push the ball down the field, Skip, I don't think they're doing Tom a great service. Mm. They're doing him a disservice. And it shows.
Mm. Okay, so for me, the Brady hate I experience knows no bounds.
Who hates on him now?
This new narrative about, it's almost like an aha moment for the many Brady haters. I'm not even talking just about you, but but they're out there in legion form. There are like billions of them. There's many Brady haters as there are LeBron defenders and lovers. So they have leaped upon this new narrative, which is completely bogus and misleading. Aha, we got him. He can't throw deep. So let's look back at what's happened. Let's look at body of work in the year 2020 at what I call Tampa Bay.
Okay.
What has happened? Well, let's look at the first eight games. That's half a football season, so that's a pretty good body of work. I'm going to use the Pro Football Focus stats here because he is, according to Pro Football Focus, one for his last 19 deep throws.
Okay.
In the last three games. Well, really, it crossed over into the Raiders game at Vegas. Mm-hmm. So it's parts of four games.
Right.
But after eight games, they were 6-2.
Right.
Guess what Tom Brady was on deep balls at that point?
What was he?
He was 17 for 39. He had almost completed half of his 20-plus mm-hmm. yard throws for a grand total of 583 yards. All of those, the 17 deep completions and the 583 deep yard completions, led all of football.
Okay.
So don't tell me he can't throw deep because that's what he was doing the best through the first eight games, and they got all the way to 6-2.
Right.
Well, now he's one for his last 19 for a grand total of 44 yards. What happened? What was the new X factor? Tom Brady said, we got to go get Antonio Brown. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
And they tried to force Antonio into an equation that was working at a high level. Mm-hmm. Because at 6-2, even you were agreeing, yeah, they look like they could be the best team.
Mm-hmm.
So Tom's playing at a high level. Pro Football Focus has him graded at least in the top five. Even last week, they had him up to second in overall rating for the whole year.
Right.
And yet, once they've added Antonio Brown and they ran into two really good defenses on back-to-back games in prime time at home, they ran into the Saints, who can rush for and get you, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they were all over Tom Brady on that night. Meanwhile, right on schedule, Tampa Bay's defense, Todd Bowles' defense that I had so much respect for, has gone completely kaput and south. And they gave up 420 yards to Drew Brees and 413 to Jared Goff. Well, it's going to be hard to overcome that when you're up against two defenses that rank Rams number one in fewest yards allowed, and New Orleans ranks number three in fewest yards allowed.
Well, if you combine those two defenses and put them together, they still should be no match for the GOAT.
Okay, but the GOAT was overmatching everybody he played because he was no risk it, no biscuit at the highest level. He was leading the league in big-time throws, which are 20-plus yard throws.
So where were those, since you talked about the reason why he's not getting big-time throws because of the defense that he was playing, when he went 17 of 36, where were those defenses ranked? Were any of those big-time throws against Chicago? With any of those big-time throws against New Orleans? With any of those big-time throws against the Rams? So, in other words, you're taking advantage of bottom feeders defensively. So, again, to make a long story short.
Well, I told you in their seven win. You know, I've got seven of their eight wins. I'm sorry, six of their seven wins. He lit it up. He's got 19 touchdowns to one interception. And if you want to say these are bottom feeders, Denver's defense, the Chargers, Green Bay's defense.
Terrible.
Raiders defense. Giants defense that you've come around, now you're driving their bandwagon, and at Carolina, which they had just gone up to Mahomes and Bridgewater had outplayed Mahomes at Kansas City.
You do know that if this doesn't go well, you know who this is going to fall on, right, Skip? It's going to be on Brady.
Okay, that's fine. Well, he He's bought into this. This is what he asked for.
Because okay? I've given you everything you've asked for.
Okay. He wanted Antonio Brown. But it was going to be difficult to not.
He wanted Gronk.
Okay. Remember, well, that was from the start. At least you got him from the start. There were no preseason games. Mm-hmm. There was virtual OTAs. So you got very little time to prepare to get to know a team that you didn't know at all. Everything was new. Offense, teammates, all new. So he starts out cold in week one at New Orleans, which okay. I thought was completely unfair. But then we get all the way to 6-2, and he's rolling, and he says, if I'm going to go win a Super Bowl, I need Antonio Brown. Was that big risk it for the biscuit?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, but this is what I don't get. This is what I don't get. Now, when he was 17-36,
mm-hmm.
17-39, mm-hmm. on those deep throws, yep. you didn't mention anything about no OT. They're not having OTAs. Mm. They were doing this thing by Zoom. Mm. You didn't mention anything about that. No. Now, he's 1-19 on those last throws. You mentioned that they had no OTAs. Okay. They brought in Antonio Brown. Why?
Yeah, the Hall of Famer across from me kept telling me that he's a noodle arm, spaghetti arm, that he's lost it. He's lost some velocity. I said, no, he actually looks like he's gained velocity because he's throwing the deep ball better than with more velocity than he ever threw Skip, it in New England.
Skip, what good is throwing the deep ball if it's inaccurate? What good is a 100-mile-an-hour pitch if you can't spot it?
Okay, but
if
for eight games, he was almost 50% of his deep balls. Does that work? And who was one of his favorite receivers for the deep ball? The best deep ball he threw was at Raiders, at Las Vegas, yeah. at the end of the half.
But he wasn't happy with that.
Little Scotty Miller.
He wasn't happy with that.
Okay. So he says, I got to go up one notch to Antonio Brown because, as you told me, for 5 years, he was the best receiver in football, the most productive
yes.
receiver in football.
Yes.
So Brady's saying, I don't just want to win one playoff game. I want to go win the Super Bowl right. that's going to be played right. in our stadium, right. right?
Yes.
So if I'm going to do that, I'm going to have to figure out Antonio Brown on the fly. I'm going to have to force him in and then force feed him to the detriment of my offense short term. Because long term, this might pay off. Now, maybe it won't pay off until next year.
Right.
But right now, he's trying to do something on the fly that is virtually impossible.
Are you sure he's coming back for next year?
Well, are you saying they don't want him back?
I'm just asking you, will he be? I don't know.
Huh?
I mean, it seems like every chance he gets, Bruce Arians is, you know, giving him a haircut.
Okay. Well, I hope they cut him so he can go somewhere else.
Where?
Yeah. Well, name it. Name somebody who needs a quarterback. Anybody would want him.
No, no, no.
Those numbers that he's putting up?
What numbers?
Are you I just told you what they are.
I mean, he's the 14th or 15th best quarterback right now.
Says you. I think he's a top five quarterback. Says Pro Football Focus. They still have him as a top five performing quarterback.
Pro Football Focus lost all their credibility.
Lost their mind.
The mere fact that they said he was better than Mahomes.
All I know is the man across from me for 4 straight years on Undisputed has said, this is it. This is the end of him. He's got to go home after this year.
No, he ain't got to go home,
So
Skip.
Here we are.
Skip, and I just told you the days of him being the best and you're just, oh, Tom.
Okay, but you continue to predict, oh, Tampa's still going to make the playoffs. So they're going to send him home after they make the playoffs?
Oh, well, Coach Belichick did.
Okay.
Belichick did.
Yeah, is he going to make the playoffs?
Yeah, no, that. That's
yeah.
Right. Hey, look what he did with the weapons. I mean, look at Cam. Mm. He got Jacoby Myers.
Mm.
Had 16 catches. Bird had a big day. Look at them guys, what he's doing. What Tom couldn't do.
Who got the dub in that game? I think Deshaun did.
Yo guy didn't get no dub on Monday night.
I think he's a little better off and much better position to make the playoffs than Belichick's.
Because they got to carry him. Oh. He understood he needed to go to get downstream. He needed to go with a current.
Mm.
He had to go with 2 Pro Bowl receivers.
You picked the Patriots to make the playoffs. I didn't.
Is the season over?
Yes, it's over for them.
No, it's not.
Yes.
No, it's not.
Tom has, followed up with a win after his losses as well this season. So, he's prepping right now.
No mercy.
Doug Peterson has been asked plenty about benching Carson Wentz in favor of Jalen Hurts, and his latest response didn't exactly put the issue to bed. Peterson was asked if he was switching QBs. He hesitated, then said, quote, not today on Wednesday, no. Then asked if his hesitation meant that he was at least thinking about it. He responded curtly, I think about a lot of things. Wentz is my starter, end of story. You can blow it up however you want. Sensing a little tension. Shannon, should Peterson replace Wentz with Jalen Hurts?
No, he shouldn't. I'm not going to sit here and sugarcoat anything. Carson has not played well this year, Skip, but neither has other, offense hadn't played well.
defense had played particularly well in spots. Although the defense, I believe, is a strong suit of the team, there have been times that the offense gets going, and when they need the defense to get a stop, they let the opposing offense go down the field and get more points. The injury situation. But all that aside, Carson needs to do a better job of protecting the football. Skip, I get it. The offensive line has been beat up. He hasn't had D-Jack the lion's share of the season. Alshon has been out. He's back, but he's not the Alshon of old. Zach Ertz is out. Goddard has been out for a period of time. And again, Sanders has missed time, but that's no excuse for you turning the ball over. Some of the throws and some of the interceptions that he's doing, I'm like, what the hell are you doing, Carson? You can't do that when your team is struggling. The quarterback needs to be the reason why you win. He can't be the reason why you lose because he touched the ball too much, Skip. You can't do that. But Dougie P needs to understand, stop living in the past. This is not 2017. You can't call the exact same plays that you called then because you don't have the same type of team. LeGarrette Blount and Jay Ajayi is not banging the ball. You can't play action like you once could because you can't run it. Alshon was a different animal. Goddard was he and Kelsey and Kittle, they were fighting each other. Well, Kelsey and Goddard was for who's the best tight end in football. It's not there. It's not that anymore. So you're calling the same type of plays, using all this scat protection, and you got, you're down to your third and fourth different starting lineups. So a lot of this is on Dougie P, but he's bringing a lot of this on himself because the pause when reporters ask you, you should already look. I know what they're going to ask, Skip. You know how Philly, well, you know how the media works, especially in Philly. Mm-hmm. They're going to ask you these questions. I'm already, listen, Carson is my quarterback. We're moving forward. Carson gives us the best chance to win. Now, Jalen Hurts could have made it a lot more difficult that when he comes in those cameos, he gives them something, like Taysom Hill. When Taysom Hill came into the game, Skip, what did he like, hey, look at him. Mm. He's throwing the ball. Oh, look at him running. Jalen Hurts coming in the game, has he shown you any bright spots like that? No, he hasn't. I don't believe they should go to Jalen Hurts. I believe Wentz still gives them the best chance to win.
Mm. Shannon Sharp. Here on Thanksgiving Day, you need to give up the ghost of the man you call Walk It To Him Wentz that I have renamed.
He ain't going nowhere.
Give It To Him Wentz. It's over. He has come all apart. Even if you look at the scope of his, how many years has he played now? We're up to five.
Five, 2016.
Fifth year. Since entering the league, he has the third most turnovers in the whole league to Jameis and third Cousins up in Minnesota, okay, over the last 5 years. Mm-hmm. But so far, he leads the league in interceptions. He leads the league in sacks, so he's holding on the ball too long, even though his protection has obviously broken down occasionally. Right. And his total turnovers, including the four fumbles lost, equal 18, which is five clear of the next individual on the list and is more than 29 other teams have as a team. That's abominable. That's all-time bad. And it's pretty clear the coach has given up on him.
Yeah.
Because the coach is nobody's fool. He's been around. He's done Super Bowl press conferences. He knows how the media works, mm-hmm. especially in Philadelphia. So he gets asked yesterday, are you thinking about any change at quarterback? Not today on Wednesday, no. That's you're dropping a bombshell.
Thank you.
Not today on Wednesday? And somebody says, well, what about Monday? Because they play on Monday night against Seattle at home. Long pause. I'm focused on getting better today. What? So the door is open? No. No, Carson is our quarterback. Well, you don't that doesn't sound very
convincing.
Are you
thinking about it? Well, I think about a lot of things.
Yeah, I think about a lot of things. Okay. I am a huge Jalen Hurts fan, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
I know him only from Alabama and Oklahoma. But I thought he was really good at Alabama under a lot of pressure, a lot of fire. Mm-hmm. Then he goes to Lincoln Riley, who helped transform him into a big-time college quarterback, who was second in QBR. And what I love about Jalen Hurts is he has such football character that a team wants to follow him into battle. Mm-hmm. If you gave him the reins of this team, it would be better with Jalen Hurts. I'm not saying he's more talented than Carson because Carson's up at the top of talent. what is he, 6'5"?
Yeah, big dude, strong, 235, 240, yeah.
All the above. So he's more talented. He's bigger, stronger. I don't know if he's strong because Jalen Hurts in the weight room is a beast.
Yeah.
But the point is, if you give Jalen Hurts the reins, he'll take over the locker room and take over the huddle and take over the team. And he's not a gadget quarterback. He doesn't have that Taysom Hill. He's a guy who's been used to – he was a starting quarterback his first year at Alabama.
Right.
You know, like he grew up a starting quarterback. His father was his coach all the way. So he doesn't know gadgets. He's not Taysom Hill trying to make his way into the league.
But this, think about this, Skip. When Cam Newton was struggling, they ended up taking Cam out. They asked Coach Belichick, Coach Belichick, who's your Cam's our starter? They didn't ask him any more questions. It's done.
It was done.
That's how you handle that.
And he was convincing. Yep.
But when you start up, they ask you a question and you pause, what you thinking about? So that means you've actually thought about doing what we're asking you about. Or you're thinking about doing what we're asking you about.
Yep.
Oh, so you I think about a lot of things. No, I haven't thought about it. Just like with Skip. You remember when Tom Brady struggled at Arrowhead? What do they call it? The Arrowhead, whatever, Monday Night Mask or something.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the 38 or whatever.
Yeah, the 44-14, something like that.
44-14.
They asked Coach Belichick, are you going to bench Tom? Are you thinking about going? He laughed at him.
He said, I'm on to Cincinnati.
Come on.
And all they did was go win the
Super Bowl.
Yep.
After they, and as a matter of fact, Cincinnati was, if I'm not mistaken, 6-0 at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And they whitewashed him and
they wiped
him
out. And here they went.
Doug, you bringing this on yourself.
So I'm going to say it again. I told you this before the year. As a lifelong Cowboy fan, I have one fear in this division, and that is that they will hand the reins to Jalen Hurts because I would be in trouble if they do that. That's how much I believe in this
young
man.
You should have another fear, the Cowboys.
Mm.
They will do Cowboy things. I'm counting on it.
Yep.
Don't let me down, Cowboys. Do what you normally do at this time of year.
I'm going to be right here at 9:30 Eastern tomorrow morning, and I hope you show up.
Okay.
Because you might want the day off.
Your day coming.
Yeah.
You see how happy you get this week?
You want tomorrow
no,
off?
No, I don't need tomorrow.
I can just debate myself.
No, I'm good.
No mercy.
Photos of LeBron working out with his son, Bronny, went viral on Twitter yesterday. And honestly, you can see the resemblance right away as Bronny has clearly hit a growth spurt. LeBron has said he's dreamed of playing alongside his son one day. And even though Bronny is only 16 years old, he already looks like he has the height to make the NBA. So, Shannon, what was your reaction?
He's growing. He's growing into that body. Yeah. I mean, we know his dad, LeBron. But his mom was a great athlete in her own right, great softball player. And had she stuck with it, like we talk about Kat Osterman or Monica Abbott or Kehlani Ricketts, mm-hmm. Natasha Watley, we might be talking about Savannah Brinson.
Maybe.
Yeah!
Mm.
And that boy from Goodstock, like O'Shea Sharp.
Mm.
Yeah, I was born in 68, but I didn't come out of Woodstock. I came out of Goodstock.
You got a good stock.
When them Porter and Sharps got together, you got two NFL players.
Sure you weren't at Woodstock, for sure.
I was not. So, Skip. And look, I mean, you could tell his body is starting to mature. He's starting like, hey, that boy got a dad body.
Talk about a growth spurt.
Yeah.
When I saw this, I said, he looks 6'5"?
Yeah.
Does he? I know LeBron's kind of leaning over.
But he looks solid, though.
Well, he's been living in the weight room.
He's been on that iron. Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
So, again, his father is 6'9". So, could Bronny be 6'7"? Who knows?
Yeah.
But again, it looks like... from the last time I saw him as a freshman in high school, he looked like he was 6'1", maybe?
Yeah. I don't know if he was that tall, but, I mean, he looked, I mean, wow.
I mean, unless LeBron had this Photoshop, but I don't think he did.
No.
Not for Bronny, right?
I mean, he growing. I mean, I had a little growth spurt like that. I went from 5'5", 132 as a freshman to about 5'9". About 155 as a sophomore, and I was like 175 as a junior. Then I was like 182.
Well, you got a long way to go to catch this kid, because that's
yeah.
That's
well, he out. Already yeah. Well, he already bigger than I was as a sophomore. I mean, 6'2". He lucky probably about 170.
And then LeBron threw me because at first glance I couldn't figure out what he was. I said, "Are you throwing down gang signs or what?" He's doing four.
You know what bold is? That's four for four.
I was happy he's pointing them down because they deserve to be pointed down because he's got this many losses in the finals.
Guess when he take a picture next year with Bronny?
Huh. He'll be like this here.
Really?
He'll be like this here so y'all can see if, yes, what he can do.
You guaranteeing that?
And then next year, you're going to have somebody with some fingers in there because they're going to have somebody got to get an extra thing in there.
I may have to post something today on IG.
You ain't got to post
something like this.
You ain't got to do
anything. And everybody will know.
You ain't got to do anything. You ain't got to do anything. You ain't got no business posting. Skip, hold on. This is about LeBron and Bronny, and Bronny hitting a growth spurt and starting to all of a sudden, he's like, okay, now.
So give the kid his stage. You don't need to be doing this.
Skip, he giving him his stage. He working with, what better teacher? You got him to go.
None better. In that sport, none better. I give you that.
I mean, if Einstein had a kid, you think he going to send him to a tutor?
I mean, unless you had Jordan, but Jordan teaches nobody. Jordan's above teaching it. He didn't want to teach his own kids. He is unto himself.
I'm sure, but it's hard. I think the thing is, Skip, it's just hard because everything basketball, we think, not to say LeBron didn't work, but there are some gifts that come so natural to you that it's not coming as natural to LeBronny, to Junior, as it came to him. And it's hard. That's what people are like, Shannon, why don't you coach? You know, I can't coach because I ain't got no patience.
Yep, I agree.
You got to have patience to coach, even your kids.
Well, the early reviews on Bronny projecting just college basketball was that he was just going to be pretty good as a college basketball player. Well, now you give him that spurt, and if I would think he would still have a couple of more inches of growth in him.
Yeah, it's hard to see a situation where he's not going to be at least 6'4", 6'5".
Okay, but doesn't he look 6'5"?
Yeah. No, I think he's probably about 6'2", 6'3". But he saw, he getting his dad's body. Hey, that's what he's starting to fill out.
Whew.
Because you know his dad.
His dad.
You know his dad.
No, got it. I give you all that. But
Kawhi.
That kid's neck is even beyond LeBron.
Yeah.
That looks like a weight room neck.
Kawhi better be getting up them shots. Hope Kawhi is training in the lab, because you know last year they were in the lab. Somebody talk about they're in the lab, but we be in the lab putting that work in. Hope he getting that work in.
Kawhi doesn't have to post it. He just does it.
Does what? What'd he do? Go in the second round? That's what he need to post. Post that. Going out in the second round. How you score 2 points in the second half? Hey, Skip.
You should have a Corona today because you just won the Corona championship.
No, you did.
Skip. That's what you did.
We're going to win this one, too.
Yeah.
We're going to win 2021.
Coronavirus championship. Have a Corona today.
I don't think that's
five. We're going to have five or five, Skip.
We're not calling it that.
No mercy.
Well, we're just a few hours away from the Cowboys taking on Washington in Fox's Thanksgiving showcase at 4 p.m. Eastern. Zeke is coming off his first 100-yard rushing game of the season, and Dallas is 23-4 when he crosses the century mark. So, Shannon, will Zeke go over 100 yards again today?
I'm going to say he gets close. I'll say he'll be somewhere between 85 and 95, but he doesn't go over. Washington's only allowed one 100-yard rusher. And that was Nick Chubb that got 108. So I'm going to say no. He will be the focal point of the Washington defense.
Yep.
They will know they have to neutralize him and Tony Pollard. Now, they get over 100 as a team, but I don't believe Zeke is the one that goes over 100 by himself.
Bingo. I will agree with you. I say Zeke gets only 70 today. Eats a little bit, but not a lot. He watches his weight today, right?
Okay.
But I say Tony Pollard does get loose a couple of times, and he has 50 himself.
Okay.
And I say my man CeeDee Lamb is also going to get loose a couple of times on jet sweeps. And I say he will total 25 yards rushing. So I say my team will wind up with 145, 145 yards rushing, and I will have a very happy Thanksgiving. Thank you.
No, I don't care if you have 245. You're losing. I'm coming in here happy, full, and happy tomorrow.
This sets up play action for the real AD on this show, who is Andy Dalton. Andy Dalton.
I'm going to have my dessert first. I'm going to have some of that old sweet potato pecan pie. That's what I made last night. mac and cheese. Yeah, with the iron skillet. Yeah, I got that. Blueberry cornbread. I know your mouth out there watering, but it's all mine. I'm
going to
be full and happy because you're losing.
No dessert for me.
Full and happy.
Just the Cowboy game.
Well, that's the dessert for
me. Watching
the beating the brakes off.
We appreciate
y'all.
You spending your Thanksgiving morning with us. Have a great rest of your day.
Undisputed.